Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 14322 in the name of Jenny O'Ruth on Programme for Government Eradicating Child Poverty. I invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Jenny O'Ruth to speak to and move the motion around 12 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name. Ending child poverty is the single greatest priority for this government and is what I hope is a truly national mission supported across this chamber. I'm pleased to be opening this debate as Education Secretary in what I hope is a demonstration of the cross-government approach that we are taking to this mission. Of course, ending child poverty is a job not just for me or for the Social Justice Secretary or for the Health Secretary or for any one of my colleagues. It is a mission for all of us in government at all levels. And undoubtedly, we approach this mission in what are clearly challenging circumstances. The Scottish Government's budget is under the most severe and sustained pressure since this Parliament was reconvened in 1999. However, Presiding Officer, it is worth reminding the Chamber that it is within that challenging context we are already taking considerable action to alleviate child poverty within our current devolved powers. We are investing around £3 billion per year in our mission to eradicate child poverty, to address the cost of living crisis and to break the cycle of poverty. And we know that action is making a difference. Modelling published in February estimates that 100,000 children will be kept out of relative poverty this year by Scottish Government policies such as the Scottish Child Payment, with relative child poverty levels estimated to be 10 percentage points lower than they otherwise would have been. And as Professor Morag Treanor from Glasgow University has observed, the Scottish Child Payment has been a game changer for Scotland, noting levels of child poverty in Scotland will drop faster and further than they will in the rest of the UK, particularly England, because of this payment. There is, however, much more we need to do in order to fully eradicate child poverty. Happy to do so.
Willie Rennie.
The First Minister yesterday made quite a lot of deal about the whole family approach, the interconnected approach that was required in order to help families. But there was no reference in the Programme for Government or its contribution to the whole family wellbeing fund, which was £500 million up until 2026. And that's caused some concern that there's no specific reference. Can she put her minds at rest and commit to that £500 million by 2026?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Rennie for his intervention. He may know that I'm actually recused from the promise because my wife sits on the Oversight Board. However, I'm sure that my colleague Ms Somerville will respond to that point specifically in the summing up. I mentioned, Presiding Officer, that this year's Programme for Government really reinforces our work in terms of a partnership approach with local government and stakeholders across whole family support that Mr Rennie mentioned, employability, childcare, education and housing. Because, Presiding Officer, that government alone will not eradicate child poverty, it's going to take all of us across Scotland working together, united in focus and purpose to deliver the change required. Happy to do so.
Jeremy Walfer.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary, you talk about family provision. One of the family provisions that allows people to go out who are disabled is changing place toilets. But your government announced on Tuesday that the £10 million fund to help those become new changing place toilets had been removed. How does that help families, particularly those in poverty, to go out and access services in our cities and towns?
Secretary.
Well, look, I think Mr Balfour raises an extremely valid point, and I recognise the challenge in this instance. He will also recognise the very real challenges the Scottish Government faces at the current time, largely driven as a result of decisions taken elsewhere, which have driven inflation to such levels that we have had to settle, for example, record levels of local government pay deals. I think that was the right thing to do, but it does mean that there is less finance for other projects, such as the one that Mr Balfour has talked to. I also recognise the importance of that fund in my own constituency and in other places in Scotland. And as with all of the funding that we're all considering in government, if additional funding becomes available, we will prioritise that funding to help support families that are most in need. And I want to talk to some of that support and investment we are already providing in Scotland. Investment, Presiding Officer, that doesn't necessarily exist in other parts of the UK at the current time. So, for example, the emergency fund to support councils in removing the impact of school meal debt on families, in building our existing partnerships in Glasgow, in Clackmannanshire and in Dundee. We're also investing in 5 more place-based partnerships. And it's also why we're investing in local projects to tackle child poverty through a second round of our Child Poverty Practice Accelerator Fund. And we know that breaking the cycle of poverty means supporting the next generation to thrive and helping parents to get on in fair work. And of course, Scotland is the only part of the UK to already offer 1,140 hours of early learning and childcare to all 3 and 4 year olds and to eligible 2 year olds, regardless of their parents' working status. And that provision of extra ELC is helping to save families on average £5,500 per child per year if they pay for it themselves. So we know I'd like to make some progress. We know that it's making a substantial difference already by saving families money and also, importantly, allowing women to return to the workplace. And of course, in 2024-25, we will continue to invest around £1 billion in high-quality ELC, and we will continue to expand access to funded childcare for families who need it most through our work locally in the 6 early adopter communities. In those early adopter communities, we've been working with families most at risk from poverty since 2022 to provide them with the school-aged child services that they need. And families tell us, Presiding Officer, that funding is making a difference. It's helping to get them back into work and also helping to alleviate pressure on household budgets. And of course, I'm mindful of time, Presiding Officer.
Duncan Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking that intervention, and she'll be aware that a survey conducted by Pregnant Then Screwed found that of parents who are eligible for the new government-funded childcare scheme, a quarter of mothers on maternity leave have been told they cannot apply for the free hours, even though they are eligible for this, and as a result, will have to return to work early. How does the Cabinet Secretary respond to that?
Cabinet Secretary, I can give you the time back for the interventions.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy to work with the member and, of course, with Ms Dawn as Children's Minister to resolving the matter that she has raised today, although I do think it is important to note on record that 1140 that's already available in Scotland is quite different to that which is available in other parts of the UK, and which actually, particularly in relation to Conservatives' approach, really linked to having parents in work. We do not discriminate on that basis in Scotland. I think it's a much more equitable offer. But I'm happy to work with the member to supporting that work further. Presiding Officer, I mentioned that we are delivering childcare. I want to come on to talk about school-aged childcare, which is hugely important for parents, that wraparound childcare provision, which we are providing to support around 600 children from 500 families through our early adopter projects that I mentioned. The programme for government also highlights a very real example of the difference that project in Dundee is making to one mum who's been able to get back into work with the right support and funded childcare, that wraparound approach that we know works and helps to support parents into sustained destinations. But it's also imperative that we continue to drive an increase in the take-up of funded early learning and childcare for eligible two-year-olds. And I know this is something that our local authorities take very seriously, and we will continue to work with them to focus on boosting take-up among the families most at risk from poverty. Over 24-25, we will continue to support the Extra Time programme, investing £4 million in a partnership with the Scottish Football Association to deliver before, after school and breakfast clubs through 31 football clubs spread all over the country. That funding is providing 3,000 targeted free places each week for children who are benefiting from access to food, activities and support while their parents are more easily able to work. Presiding Officer, let me turn now to school and post-16 education. By investing in children and young people's education to enable them to begin work, further or higher education when they leave school, we can help to break the poverty-related cycle. Through our continued investment in the Scottish Attainment Challenge, we have seen the poverty-related gap for young people leaving school and going on to a positive destination reduced by 60% since 2009. Further, we've seen record levels of attainment in literacy and numeracy in our primary 7 pupils in the past year. And as this year's exam results show, a 25% increase this year alone in the number of technical and vocational qualifications achieved. This is a true mark of progress as more young people are able to choose non-traditional routes in their qualifications to exhibit their success. We've also seen extraordinary success with the Widening Access Agenda, a partnership with our universities, with record numbers of students from our poorest communities going on to university, supported by free university tuition. And indeed, the most recent UCAS data from August showed a 12% increase this year in acceptances from the 20% most deprived areas of Scotland. That is a record that we, our universities, and us should be, importantly, our students should be proud of. Presiding Officer, our support to young people is not just academic. We understand that families need our support at this time, and we are taking strong action to reduce the cost of the school day for families. That's why we've extended free school meals, saving families £400 per year for every eligible child taking those meals. And as was confirmed yesterday, we will focus the next stage in our efforts on free school meal expansion on those children who need it most. That is why, even in the extremely tough financial challenging circumstances we face as a result of UK government austerity. We are investing to deliver free school meal expansion in primary 6 and 7 pupils in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. Real action in our mission to eradicate child poverty, which I hope everyone in this chamber could support. Very shortly, in the coming weeks, we will publish school clothing and uniform guidance, which will focus on measures to support schools to design and implement affordable policies that recognise the individual needs and identity of our pupils. We will also continue to provide funding to all local authorities for the removal of core curriculum charges for all primary and secondary pupils, worth £8 million in this financial year alone. And we're investing £1 billion during this parliamentary term through the Scottish Attainment Challenge, helping schools to fund things like income maximisation officers at Braes High School in Falkirk, supporting families to access the benefits they're entitled to, supporting Fair Isles Primary School in Fife, who are using some of their PEF funding for a family worker to support parents in boosting their household budgets, and in Elgin High School in Moray, who are tackling further the cost of the school day by introducing a food-to-go scheme. Presiding Officer, I've referred throughout the statement to the need for joint working if we are to succeed in our mission to end child poverty. Joint working within government, joint working with councils, joint working with the third sector and directly with our communities. But I now need to touch on the joint working that would be most impactful immediately. That's genuine joint working with the UK government. Because as the Chamber knows, the UK government has powers at its fingertips right now which could alleviate child poverty. And at the stroke of a pen, they could lift hundreds of thousands of children in Scotland out of poverty by taking the obvious step of lifting the two-child cap. So I am asking again today that this Parliament come together and call on the UK government to do exactly that. I speak in particular to colleagues in the Labour benches today, because I do not believe that there is a single person on those benches who truly believes that the two-child limit is the right policy. And members of this Parliament, each of us, of course, sees the impact of this policy in our constituencies every day. Today, we have the opportunity to speak with one voice, and the people who sent us here will expect us to take it. The two-child limit must go, and it must go now. Presiding Officer, there are other costs the Scottish Government incurs, primarily those associated with mitigation. And indeed, it is worth reminding the Chamber that as a Government, we are spending over £1 billion mitigating the impacts of 14 years of UK Government policy, such as, of course, the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. That is action we are proud to take to protect our people and to protect families in Scotland. But we shouldn't have to take it. For the purpose of this Parliament is not to ameliorate bad decision-making from Westminster. The purpose of this Parliament should be to govern in the best interests of the people of Scotland. Yet we are spending millions of pounds this year alone to mitigate those UK government welfare cuts, including, as I mentioned, the bedroom tax and the benefit cap, money which could and which should have been spent on our schools or on further ambitious anti-poverty measures. Rather than these policies being mitigated in Scotland, the new UK Labour government has a chance to end them at source. And indeed, Labour have some tough decisions fast approaching, for with the great responsibility of government comes great accountability. So I give a warning to Labour colleagues today, because if they are not careful, the Tory bedroom tax will become the Labour bedroom tax. The two-child cap will become Labour's two-child cap. And the child poverty that these reprehensible policies lead to will become Labour's child poverty. There is an opportunity for the new UK government to change course, and in this government they will find a willing partner. But emulating Tory austerity is not going to help Scotland's children. Things have got to get better. Presiding Officer, eradicating child poverty is the golden thread that runs through this year's programme for government. It is a priority for all of our portfolios. And whilst we have made good progress, we know there is more to do, and we remain resolutely committed to delivering the change needed. We will leave no stone unturned across government as we seek to lift every child out of poverty. And I ask each member of every party in this Parliament to work with us on this national mission. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I can advise the Chamber we've got a little time in hand, so I would encourage both members that haven't yet pressed their buttons but wanting to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. I'd also encourage members wishing to make an intervention to also press their intervention buttons as well, as it is not least because it's helpful for those joining us online. And with that, I now call Miles Briggs to speak to and move Amendment 143.22.2 around 8 minutes. Mr. Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy President. Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the many organisations which have provided very useful briefings ahead of today's debate. Yesterday, during the programme for government statement, the First Minister said no child should have their opportunities, their development, their health and well-being and their future curtailed by the material wealth of their family. Not ever and certainly not today in a modern, prosperous society like Scotland. I agree. We all want to see a Scotland where everyone and every child can realise their potential. The programme for government was an opportunity, though, to take stock of the successes and failures of this government. Something I agree with the First Minister on is when he says families thrive when they are supported by coordinated holistic services that meet their needs and are easy to access. That's why I'm disappointed that both health and housing have seen such a low priority in the child poverty actions and indeed are not even referenced in the government motion for today. After 17 years of being in government and having full control over these policy areas, the facts speak for themselves. The percentage of children in Scotland waiting over 12 weeks for medical care has increased by almost 50%. Total number of children on waiting lists sits at over 10,000, a 114% increase. To quote the Cabinet Secretary, these are SNP waiting lists. The number of children who are homeless and living in temporary accommodation has reached over 16,000 SNP child homelessness. The government is not making the progress it promised. And indeed, the situation in health and housing for children, often the most vulnerable children in our society, is only getting worse. There is a cross-party consensus in this Parliament, but perhaps more importantly, in the charities and public bodies working in communities across Scotland, for us to take action to actually make a change in this area. The government motion states that a sustained and cohesive effort is needed across all levels of government and in all parts of society to deliver on the national mission, and I agree with that. But if ministers are serious about eliminating child poverty and it being the government's number one priority, then we need to see a renewed focus on outcomes, not government processes, which have been, to date, all we have seen. Because, Presiding Officer, I recently chaired or co-chaired a parliamentary roundtable alongside Jackie Bailey, organised by the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, to discuss their recommendations in the Worried and Waiting report. And I have to say, I, along with many MSPs who are in the chamber today, were really concerned with what the professionals had to say in the room. And today I make the sincere plea to the First Minister to hopefully meet with them urgently to consider some of their recommendations about how we need to make child poverty and child health outcomes go hand in hand, because we need to see action. Because I do believe that the waiting times we are seeing is the next big scandal facing this government. Since the pandemic, I know many MSPs will have started receiving casework and examples of unacceptable failures to deliver health and mental care time support on time. That is something we need to see actions on, and I would urgently request the First Minister to look at some of what the Royal College have outlined, which I believe are fully realistic and affordable recommendations for the Scottish Government to take forward. One of those being a full review of the child health workforce to ensure it's sufficiently resourced, funded, but also looking specifically to the creation of a bespoke child health workforce strategy. These are things which I think we could all agree on and can make a difference. I'd also call on the Health Secretary to consider these challenges and make a statement to Parliament, because this is only getting worse on the government's watch. And I have been disappointed to date to see the limited lack of progress that we have seen by government to end the practice of children and young people being placed in adult mental health services. I've held roundtables, we've had meetings all summer, and ministers have not acted on that, and we are seeing the practice continue. We need to see leadership, and I hope the Health Secretary, he's not here today, but will look to how we act on that. Deputy Presiding Officer, the housing emergency is also one of the key areas this government needs to act on, and I welcome some of the changes the programme for government outlined within the housing bill and look forward to meeting with the housing minister to discuss these. In many ways, though, the changes proposed are fixing the mess which was created during the SNP Green coalition government period. During the passage of the National Planning Framework Bill, alongside industry leaders, we warned ministers that without a pipeline of land supply for new homes, we would see housing developments and home completions significantly reduce, and that is what we have seen. As the Federation of Housing Associations point out in their briefing, the pipeline of new social homes is slowing to worrying levels. Housing Association starts with just 2,073 homes in 2023, the lowest number since 1988. The proposals the government are now suggesting look almost identical to what I tried to get within the National Planning Framework, so I do welcome a lot of that. But the mid-market rent sector has collapsed in Scotland, and the pledge of 2,800 homes is low in comparison to what can and should be being achieved. Now, the rent controls policy, whilst politically well-meaning in the short term, has had long-term consequences, and we need to accept that. And as a result, we are seeing renters, especially here in the capital, priced out of homes, especially new tenants trying to find a home. Missing from the actions within the housing crisis are new actions around void and empty properties. It's an issue I know many SNP members who also serve on the local government committee are as frustrated as I am. In Edinburgh today, we see 3,000 empty council-owned properties sitting empty. That is totally unacceptable and has remained at that level for years now during the housing emergency we are experiencing here in the capital. And so one of my requests to ministers is for them to take forward a joint piece of work with councils to urgently audit and allocate these properties to get them back into use. That means councils fixing them, if I can get back some time. Yeah.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Member mentioned that he was due to meet the Housing Minister soon. I'm sure during that meeting he can furnish you with the details of the work that we are undertaking with COSLUT, specifically to look at the issue of voids, what national government do, what local government responsibility is, because quite frankly the voids in some councils have been too long and it is their responsibility, but also, for example, what energy providers can do, because one of the main challenges is around meter changes that we need to take place. So we are working on that, but we'll furnish the member with more details.
Miles Briggs, I can give you the time.
I welcome that and I have been in constant discussion with the Housing Minister, but I think there's new models we also need to look towards which just haven't been taken forward. For example, during the summer, I met with a charity called Right There in Glasgow. It's a charity working to prevent people becoming homeless and separated from their loved ones. And they've taken over properties, they've had them leased to them. There are many charities looking to provide that extra care housing, which I think would make a huge difference. Councils have in the past used that model, but we haven't seen as many brought forward. So I do hope we can see that different model. And there should be no empty homes sitting for years on end, like we're seeing here in the capital. Perth and Kinross Council have to be praised, I think, for the work which they have been doing with PKC Let's to bring those homes back into use. But we do need to see changes. And finally, on the issue of free school meals and the announcement yesterday that SNP ministers plan not to deliver on the commitment to expand free school meals to all primary schools, all primary age pupils. This was a policy Scottish Conservatives championed at the 21 election and one which I believe there was cross-party consensus to have a positive impact on child poverty and address stigma, as was raised during First Minister's questions. The promise to expand eligibility to all pupils was made in the last year's programme for government, and MSPs across the chamber were working to deliver that. We on these benches do want to see that policy delivered and indeed have looked to models to help support the continuation of that, not just during the school week but during summer holidays. I'm therefore extremely disappointed that we have seen ministers take this action and hope that we genuinely can see a change. The First Minister said yesterday the government does not command a majority in this parliament. Scottish Conservatives want to work then cross-party in this parliament to make sure that we do see progress on this issue and that it's fixed at the budget time, if not before, because resources have been allocated to councils. And I hope the First Minister can be open to how do we restore this policy and the costs associated with its delivery, for example, a cross-party committee to look at that and how we can deliver the policy. Finally, I am disappointed that the government's decided to not proceed with the Learning Disability Autism and Neurodivergence Bill and the Human Rights Bill. Ministers have made pledges to many MSPs that both these bills would include important changes in legislative vehicles to deliver reforms. Where they will now go, we do not know. Finally, the programme for government was a missed opportunity to develop opportunities to end child poverty. We need to work across party to do that. And I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Paul O'Kane to speak to move amendment 14322.1, around 6 minutes. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. And as always, when we debate child poverty in this chamber, I start with the consensus that I think we have already heard this afternoon, that there is no more important mission and no more important goal, and indeed no more important subject, I think, that we debate in this chamber. And of course, the goal to eradicate child poverty is laudable, and the government's motion sets that out. And you find no disagreement in terms of there being a need for a national mission than from these benches. But I think we have to be realistic, because this is a programme for government debate, and reflect that this Scottish Government have been saying that they want to take meaningful action on child poverty for the past 17 years. Indeed, the First Minister said yesterday that he has been in this Parliament for every single programme for government. I've only been in this Parliament for four programmes for government under three SNP First Ministers now. Two of them were in the chamber. I know that the First Minister had to go to another engagement. But the reality is, each time there has been a programme for government under these successive First Ministers, child poverty has been, and tackling child poverty has been, at the top of the agenda. And yet we know that year after year, things have not been getting better. In fact, they have very often been getting worse. And what we've had is re-announcement and re-announcement of policy, and very little in the way of new and innovative thinking. And I think that's borne out by much of the commentary we've seen in the last day or so on the programme for government. Because we should look, Presiding Officer, at the numbers. 30,000, that's how many children are in relative poverty. More children are in relative poverty when the SNP came to office 17 years ago. 30,000 more children, that's 260,000. In a moment, I'll just make this point. 260,000 in total across Scotland, according to the most recent figures. And they will go through the important years of their life without many of the essentials that they need. And I'll give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
Member for giving way. I'm listening to him recount the challenges that the Scottish Government faces, and I hope he will also be mindful that the Scottish Government does not exist in a financial silo. And I wonder if he agrees with Child Poverty Action, who noted in February of this year, Holyrood policies are working, but the UK Government must also invest in social security to reverse long-term damage to living standards, starting by scrapping the two-child limit and the benefit cap, and by restoring the value of child benefit. Does he agree?
Paul O'Kane.
Well, the Cabinet Secretary, we have debated child poverty, I think, probably five or six times pre-election in this chamber, and each time we've debated these issues, I have been very clear that the financial decisions and the ruinous policies of the Conservative Party are, of course, have led to an exacerbation of poverty. And that is what the new Labour government, 8 weeks in, is going to set about beginning to fix. We have to fix the foundations of our economy. We have to make sure that work crucially pays. And that's why one of the first actions that the Labour government took was to instruct the Low Pay Commission to look at how we make the national minimum wage a living wage, how we implement a new deal for working people that will create security at work, that will make sure that zero-hours contracts are gone, that will make sure that people do not have to worry about working two and three insecure jobs. Because we know crucially, and the organisations that the Cabinet Secretary has referenced will say, that in-work poverty is a serious issue that we need to deal with if we're going to deal with child poverty. And of course, she makes the point about the social security system at a UK level. And of course, we now have a child poverty task force at the UK level who are looking at reforming universal credit, because we know that universal credit does not work and needs to be fundamentally reformed. And that is the work that we have undertaken with just 8 weeks of a government at the UK level. But the SNP, as I have said already, has had 17 years. And those numbers I read out are 17 years of, quite frankly, failure when it has come to many of these policies. And what we've had, I think, in the programme for government is a sense that there is no new thinking, there is very little imagination, and we have seen the broken promises, I think, that have been made, and they've been referenced already by colleagues around the chamber. And it's not just me and the Labour Party that are making this analysis of the government's work on these issues. Indeed, their own Poverty and Inequality Commission has said that progress to reach the legally binding targets that were agreed by all parties in this chamber have been, and I quote, slow or not evident at all, and that without immediate and significant action, the Scottish Government are not going to meet those targets. And there is so much more that needs to happen in order to drive our progress towards those targets. And of course, colleagues, when they make their contributions, will outline much of this in more detail, but it's clear that we need to have more funding and support to local authorities to ensure that they can deliver at the local level in terms of tackling poverty and inequality for children and young people. We need to make sure that we continue to move forward on early learning and childcare. I don't think that the re-announcement of re-announcements on pilot funding is going to be enough in order to move the dial in that area. We know that alongside the work that the UK government is doing on wages and on secure work, we need to make sure that more people in Scotland can get into work. And we need to particularly support the work that's being done across the third sector in very difficult circumstances. And the committee, the Social Justice Committee, was hearing some of the challenges that exist in the third sector just this morning, and I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to look at that. But we need to make sure that the excellent work that's done, particularly to help women return to the workplace, is being well supported and well funded. And I would say that more of the same isn't going to cut it. And I was surprised this morning to hear the Deputy First Minister on Good Morning Scotland saying this about the programme for government in relation to child poverty. Sometimes it doesn't always take brand new initiatives. Sometimes it's just about focusing on the things that are working really well. Well, I think it would be useful if the Cabinet Secretary could explain what it is that is working so well when we have 30,000 more children in poverty over a 17-year period. I think I am now in my last minute, but if I can have the time.
Yes, indeed. Cabinet Secretary.
Despite the circumstances we were in with the finances, the programme that this government has is keeping 100,000 children out of poverty. Yes. I would say that is a success, if only we could do more without the shackles of Westminster.
Paul O'Kane.
Well, I mean, it would be useful to understand how that figure is arrived at, because the Deputy First Minister had some trouble, I think, on Good Morning Scotland articulating some of that this morning. So it would be useful in her summing up if she can explain how the modelling is reached in terms of that number, because there are a number of organisations who are concerned by the number that is used by the Cabinet Secretary. Presiding Officer, I am aware that I will need to conclude, and there will be much more to say, I imagine, in the coming weeks and months as the government's programme begins to move forward. But I am very clear that this side of the chamber will work constructively with the government, as they have thought to do and said that they wish to do with the UK government. I would encourage them to engage with the Child Poverty Task Force at a UK level and to support the action to create that new deal for working people and improved wages across the UK. But there can be no more important issue than tackling and eradicating child poverty, and it's something we must focus all of our energy and all of our resource to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Payne. I now call on Maggie Chapman to speak to and to move Amendment 14322.3. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. It is a time of want and a time of need. People are afraid. Some are angry. Some are beyond desperate. Children, far too many children, are hungry, cold, sleeping in unsafe places, excluded from the ordinary trips and toys that their classmates take for granted. Westminster politicians who, before they were elected, were telling stories of cohesion and solidarity, are now in government, speaking the language of austerity. They wear their self-imposed fiscal policies like medals of military virtue, justifying cuts that bite to the bone. Scotland, it seems, is imprisoned in a cage of consequentials, unable, it claims, to break the consensus and do what its people, its children in poverty, need it to do. I'm not talking about 2024, though I could be. 13 years ago, in 2011, the Christie Commission made its powerful, wise, and widely acclaimed report. It was a time of conscious austerity when social, economic and political pressures weighed heavily upon Scotland's communities. We were warned that budgets would buckle unless Scotland embraced a radically new and collaborative culture, one that recognised the devastating effect of inequality and learned to prioritise preventative measures. Tragically, that hasn't happened. As Mary Glasgow of Children First pointed out 3 years ago, marking the 10th anniversary of that report, she says this: while Christie couldn't predict the pandemic, he clearly understood that when public finances were tightest, the need for investment in prevention was greatest. Yet when budgets are squeezed, preventative spend is always the first to go. We can see this now, urgently highlighted by the programme for government briefings that we've received from civil society. Those who see, day in and day out, the excruciating impacts of not doing prevention properly, of not breaking those cycles of deprivation and trauma, of condemning another generation and another to the waste and misery of poverty, the vastly unequal risks of poor health, physical and mental, of victimisation, incarceration and early death. As the Child Poverty Action Group reiterates, prioritising further action to tackle child poverty is a long-term investment, not just for families, but for Scotland's economic security and the sustainability of public services. And the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland shared a striking example of prevention in action, of the way that short breaks for children with disabilities can forestall the need for much more overwhelming, expensive and potentially damaging forms of intervention later in their lives. Mend the roof while the sun shines, folk wisdom tells us. But if we haven't, if the sun never quite seemed bright enough and there was just so much to be done tidying up the front garden, then we need to get out in the rain and do it. This isn't about blame. Opportunities have been missed, and missed by everyone. But this is, in every sense of the word, a crisis. SUC General Secretary Ros Foyer said that cuts announced this week mean, and I quote, workers and communities across Scotland will be scarred for generations to come. Scotland's children don't need any more scars. They need, as an absolute minimum, the policies set out in our Scottish Greens amendment, an increased Scottish child payment to the value of at least £40 per week for every eligible child as soon as possible, but definitely by the end of this parliamentary term. Support into employment for parents, especially lone parents and those from minoritised communities. A full, independent and then implemented review of childcare in Scotland so we can understand exactly what is needed and where it is needed, as called for by Pregnant Then Screwed and so many other organisations. And of course, the completed rollout of universal free school meals in primary schools that has been previously promised. This is about children's rights, not just a pious aspiration to ending their poverty, but a solemn, serious obligation on the part of government to make their lives livable. Incorporation of the UNCRC was the beginning of that process. But children's rights don't stand alone. They cannot be fulfilled unless their parents' and carers' rights are protected too. As Engender rightly points out, women's poverty and children's poverty are inextricably linked. Rights to life, to decent standard of living, to privacy, to health and food, to a clean environment, to protection from discrimination. We are all vulnerable, though some of us have thicker armour to wear than others. We all need respect, care, safety and pathways to remedy when those are withheld. That's why UNCRC incorporation should have been followed by the Scottish Human Rights Bill, promised for so long, worked for so hard by so many people and groups from across Scotland, watched with hope and encouragement by the world. It is a bitter, bitter disappointment that both this bill and the one that would have protected Scotland's children from pernicious and toxic conversion practices, both are missing from this week's programme for government. In closing, Presiding Officer, poverty is a breach of human rights, as is so clearly articulated by the Poverty Alliance. We have a moral and ethical obligation to act, to protect, support, to love those who should expect to inherit the earth. Each and every one of us needs to work together to fulfil that vision and requirement. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And I now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 6 minutes, please.
I'm sure Maggie Chapman is sincere in what she's just spoken about this afternoon. But if only she had used that influence that she had in government to deliver some of those measures that she set out this afternoon, because they were sadly missing from her time in government. But in St Andrews, where I represent, There is the Old Course golf course, and it costs £300 at the height of the summer for a round of golf. Less than a mile away is the St David's Centre, which is the home to the St Andrews Food Bank. You would never think that St Andrews would have a food bank, but it has a thriving, unfortunately, a thriving food bank. The people who use that food bank come from the town, but also the wider area, and they are good people. They are good people who want to make a contribution to their society. But they are saddled with physical illness, mental illness, disability, and other factors as well that prevent them from working. And we need their talents and their skills in our society if we want our economy and our society to flourish. That should be the fundamental basis on which we approach this debate. Now, the challenge is that we have roughly one in four children just now in poverty, and the target within 5 years, just 5 years, is to get that down to 10%. The challenge is enormous. And as Paula Kane said, we have had some years to try and address this, if only we'd had that focus at an earlier stage. But nevertheless, it's good that we've got the focus in the debate. And we support, through the Programme for Government, the child payment. We think that's a good thing. But it shouldn't be seen as a mark of success that we require such a large child payment for so many people. It should be a sign of a system failure that we require such a large payment for so many people over such a long period of time. Now, of course we need it, and of course it should be in place, but we should aspire for no one to require that child payment, for no one to require that level of support from the state in such large numbers. That should be our mark of success. And I hear from ministers, quite rightly, they're proud of this child payment, but we shouldn't be celebrating the fact that so many require it. We should be regretting the fact that so many require this payment. Instead, I would want to focus on helping people to help themselves. Now, I'm not proposing to change at all the policy on the child payment, but we should be putting as much focus on the barriers for those people that I know from St Andrews who are desperate to make a contribution towards their society. Now, 2,000 people are waiting over a year to get the mental health treatment that they require. Suicides, in the last reported figures, were up 4%. But the programme for government, the costed statement on Tuesday, set out a £19 million cut to mental health support. That doesn't match up. I don't think that meets the needs of those people who are desperate to get back to work. Good education, as the Education Secretary was pointing out, is a way to lift people up. It's a great leveller. It gives people opportunities from all backgrounds. I'm a big supporter of moving into the whole vocational side. I think that's really important. Early learning and childcare is incredibly important. But the poverty-related attainment gap has hardly moved at all. And I know we've had this debate before, but the Education Secretary knows that she's not making the progress that she would want in this area. It's not going to close by 2026. It's not even going to substantially reduce by 2026. And I know that the First Minister said yesterday he hoped that the gap would be closed a bit every year by 2026. So it has been diluted significantly. And at the same time, we've seen cuts to the Pupil Equity Fund in real terms. And we don't have the young people, the two-year-olds, taking up that early learning and childcare offer that was offered way back in 2012, 2013. So we need to have a real focus on education as that great opportunity to lift people up. And then housing. 10,000 children in temporary accommodation. That should be a shame, because good housing is a way for people to thrive. A good, warm, settled home is a way that they can contribute towards society. But new starts and approvals for new properties is at a 10-year low. 10-year low. And the affordable target is all but gone, according to many of the interest groups and housing associations. The £196 million cut has dealt a massive blow to that. And I'm hoping that the Cabinet Secretary, in her summing up, will refer to the whole Family Wellbeing Fund, because it is concerning that it's not specified in the programme for government. They weren't really matching the £500 million spend by 2026. We had a long way to catch up. I'll take an intervention, yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just to make sure I don't run out of time in the closing up, I'm happy to commit the Scottish Government once again to that whole family wellbeing fund, that £500 million. Willie Rennie will know the work that we've been doing on investing the £110 million so far in that programme of activity, so hopefully get that gives him some reassurance.
Willie Rennie?
It certainly does. It will be some going to spend the £500 million by 2026, because I think only 120 has been spent so far, but I think that will make a tremendous difference if the government is able to actually implement the policy. So that is very good news and reassuring. Now, of course, the two-child cap should go. Of course that, and I hope that the Labour government at Westminster do actually get round to doing that when the finances are right for them from their policy perspective. That is, for me, an important issue, because it is a symbol of holding back people and young people from opportunities in life. But there is so much to do in this Parliament. There is so much for us to get right, whether it's on housing, on mental health, on education, on early years. There is so much to do in these areas. So I hope that this Parliament, and all the contributions from the SNP backbenchers this afternoon, that they will focus on the challenges that this place has got rather than others have got, because that way we have got a chance of reducing that child poverty in this country. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We will now move to the open debate, speeches of 6 minutes, and I call Bob Doris to be followed by Annie Wells. Mr Doris.
Thank you, President Officer. I think any reasonable person would acknowledge the massive financial investment that has went into tackling child poverty by the Scottish Government, and I think the SNP programme for government seeks to bolt down a lot of those clear successes, secure them sustainably for the future, but also look to see what we can do further. The £450 million annually with the Scottish Shell Payment, we know has made a real difference. It's part of the investment that's prevented 100,000 children falling into poverty. And importantly, and this often goes unsaid, has made a huge qualitative difference to the life of all 329,000 children that receive the Scottish Shell Payment, not just those 100,000 children. And in particular, mention should go to the range of Best Start grants and Best Start foods. Real focused investment that sometimes gets forgotten about. Maybe we have to look to see what we can do more in that area. The Scottish Government Action has removed the blight of poverty for many, and it's ensured essential cash support for many other families, given the woefully inadequate social protections of the previous UK government. And now, genuinely disappointingly, would appear to be the current UK Labour government. We know child poverty in Scotland is lower than any other part of the UK, including in Wales, where Labour have been in control since the inception of devolution there. And current statistics suggest it's 6% points lower in Scotland than the UK average, still far too high, of course. But modelling work also shows that relative child poverty in Scotland could be as much as 11 percentage points lower than the UK average. Again, still too high, but we must be doing something right in Scotland and not throw the baby out with the bathwater. And I thought Mr O'Kane talking about the Scottish Child Payment, maybe not being that effective, I think, would be throwing the baby out of the bathwater. I hope Labour have been committed to the Scottish Child Payment. I'm worried about some of his comments there. Yes?
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. I don't think you could characterise my comments as saying that the Scottish Child Payment was ineffective. And Mr Doris has heard me in this chamber, as has the Cabinet Secretary, being supportive of the Scottish Child Payment. And indeed, this party supported its inception and the work we continue to do. The point I'm making is that the government have to be very careful about what data they use and the model they use to analyse all of the impacts generally and report them to this chamber.
Bob Doris.
I think Mr O'Kane's earlier comments sit on the record, but he did. Mr O'Kane also said there that he believed the Scottish Help had been effective, and we'll return to that later in my comments. It is genuinely, therefore, wholly disheartening to see the Labour government try to apportion blame on child poverty challenges in Scotland to the Scottish Government. Yes, we've got a responsibility, but apportioning blame entirely for child poverty levels in Scotland misses that bigger picture. And now that the Labour and the UK Government, that's deeply worrying. Also, because it ignores 14 years of UK Westminster austerity, which has targeted our most vulnerable. As the FM stated earlier, it means Scotland has been swimming against the tide to tackling child poverty because of detrimental actions taken by successive UK governments. Labour ignores the divergence in child poverty between Scotland and the rest of the UK, where, quite frankly, Scotland has done far better, often with cross-party support. and we must do much more. There's a key part of the Scottish Government Amendment that I want to talk about, and that's about working constructively with the UK Labour Government. And that's why I was also disappointed to see the Labour Party here in the Scottish Parliament this afternoon not necessarily embracing that positive impact of the Scottish Child Payment, because I believe if MPs in Scotland, on a cross-party basis, and MSPs in Scotland, on a cross-party basis, believe the Scottish Child Payment has been effective, let's join together in solidarity and campaign for a child payment for England and for Wales. Mr O'Kane believes it's been effective in Scotland. Why not the same for England and Wales? At a stroke, that would release £450 million more spending every single year here in Scotland to some of the stuff that Mr Rennie and others wants to see happen. So I hope we can get that cross-party consensus here in Scotland. That would be really powerful. And perhaps we can get cross-party consensus on something else, and that is to axe the bedroom tax. Let's remember, first introduced by the Labour Party for the private rented sector, mitigated by the SNP to the tune of £618 million so far since 2013, and benefiting 92,000 households, £76 million this year alone, to target making sure that those on the lowest incomes have got enough money to pay their rent. That doesn't happen anywhere else in the UK. So let's have that cross-party solidarity, bring that money home to Scotland and help those elsewhere in the UK also. Yes, indeed.
I thank the member for taking this intervention. He talks about cross-party solidarity. Would he join that solidarity in wanting to see all P6 and 7 pupils have free school meals? And will he join that today?
Hi, Bob Doris.
I think Mr Briggs is a bit behind the times. When I moved to this Parliament in 2007, there were no universal free school meals in Scotland. I was campaigning for it up until the end of S2, quite frankly. So the fact that we've got up to P5 universal, P6 and P7 were making progress. Disappointed we can't go further just now under UK austerity. Yeah. But I'm on record saying I want free universal school meals in S1 and S2 also. So I don't know what I'm saying up to Miles Briggs, but I think I'm ready to go further than you would call for yourself. Finally, let me talk a little bit about the cliff edge created by universal credit and how it interacts with the Scottish Child Payment. I think any of universal credit that the UK Labour government does has to look at, I think, looking to see if they can support a continuation of the Scottish Child Payment once universal credit is withdrawn, because that's a real cliff edge and benefit loss to people in work, and that would benefit the kind of people that Mr Rennie again talks about, those in part-time work trying to get into full-time work, risking losing the Scottish Child Payment. That's a big financial risk for them. So let's make sure the UK system of universal credit and the Scottish system of the Scottish Child Payment talks to each other, that it dovetails, and we can work for all those people living in poverty, not just to sustain them out of poverty, but sustain them into meaningful and well-paid work also. Presiding Officer, thank you.
Thank you, Mr Doris. I now call Annie Wells to be followed by Karen Adam. Ms Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've heard today, and indeed over a number of years, who the SNP think is to blame for child poverty. And no doubt, no matter the outcome of today's debate, we'll hear it many times more. But seeing as we're standing here in Edinburgh, in the Scottish Parliament, where the SNP has been in power for more than 17 years, let's start at home. We've heard the Scottish Government talk about its commitment to eradicating child poverty. That pledge has been made in speeches, press releases, statements, manifestos, and most recently in the programme for government. But since the SNP came to power in 2007, the level of child poverty in Scotland has remained the same. Despite having full control over health, education and many other key devolved portfolio areas, nothing has changed. Perhaps some of this failure can be attributed to another SNP pledge, which came to nothing, to reduce Scotland's poverty-related attainment gap. And perhaps if ministers had succeeded in closing that educational gulf, they wouldn't need to now spend so much time talking about child poverty. And perhaps if actions even occasionally matched the warm words, tens of thousands of young lives would have been enhanced. Instead, we're back to square one. As an MSP for Glasgow Region, I see the effects of child poverty as clearly as anyone. The ripples go through society and the economy, and it can drag down schools, community centres and local facilities and worsen the mood of just about everyone. And a key infrastructure like schools are important. One way or another, most MSPs in this chamber believe that education is the best way to deliver opportunity and a way out of poverty. All kids deserve to go to school where they will be cared for, educated well and nurtured. It should be that way from the moment they step inside the school gates for the first time, as so many young ones have done across the country in the last few weeks. And one immediate commitment which the government could make is to properly roll out free lunch for every pupil in primary school, but as we've heard today, that won't be happening. But that would ensure at the very least those children weren't being expected to learn on an empty stomach and would also take some pressure off the household budgets for many hard-pressed families. And there's more that can be done. Violence in schools has become a real problem in recent years, with a number of news reports showing increases in pupils being attacked, as well as teachers. And the very fact that the Education Secretary made a statement on this matter earlier in the week proves there must be a growing problem. We can't have young people too scared to attend class and teachers too frightened and downtrodden to work. We need to give schools the powers and resources to properly crack down on bad behaviour, which can ruin the experience for a whole class and drives down the overall performance of a school. But it's the failure to close the poverty-related attainment gap which causes the most long-term damage. Despite this being the former First Minister's famous top priority, in the years since it has been downgraded to something that one minister recently described as exceptionally difficult, if not impossible. That dearth in ambition was played out in the recent figures which showed the gap widened in the last year from 16 points to 17.2. Thousands and thousands of children whose futures are determined by where they grow up, and the conditions aren't much better for their parents. The situation around childcare is quite frankly a mess, making it more difficult for parents. And let's face it, it's almost always women. So to get back to work and to get the family bank balance up again, they need proper childcare. And research has repeatedly shown in Scotland that parents are not getting the childcare they want nor need. Despite an expansion in free childcare, the system remains fragile, according to Scotland's own public services watchdog. It is going to be harder to change the short, medium and long-term prospects of any family if the children aren't getting on as they should in school and the parents aren't able to have the flexibility they need to work. It is within the gift of the Scottish Government to find a way of solving these problems. Presiding Officer, research has shown time and again that the people of Scotland want the Scottish and UK governments to work more closely together. They want this to be the case across all areas and at all times. But never has the case for joint working and collaborative effort been more essential than enhancing the prospects of the next generation. This can't be done unless real changes are made and the dial on child poverty shifted once and for all. My party agrees with John Swinney that this is one of the single most important objectives, and it's time for both governments to show they really mean it. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wells. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Michael Mara. Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm really grateful, actually, to stand here today and to speak about one of the most pressing issues that we face in Scotland, and that is child poverty. It's a call to create a society where every child, no matter their life circumstances, can realise their full potential. That every child has a full tummy, a home fit for purpose, and clothing that they feel comfortable and happy in. While writing this speech, it gave me cause to reflect on moments in my life, as I'm sure we all do when we're pondering issues of debate. And I remember back to a time in my life when I was scared for the future of my children, as I became a newly single mother. My circumstances changed unexpectedly and the challenges that lay ahead felt very overwhelming. But because of the safety net of our welfare system, my children and I were able to remain stable. I didn't have to move them from their home, from their schools, from their friends, and I could focus on ensuring that they had food, shelter, and most importantly, security. That support was crucial to our well-being, and today five of my children are in further education and I'm standing here in this Parliament serving my community. Without that safety net, my story might have been very different, and that's the reality for many families. Poverty is not just a statistic, it's a barrier that can prevent children from achieving their dreams and from fulfilling their true potential. And when we talk about realising potential, we're talking about more than just individual success. It is good for the child and for the family, but it does go further. It's good for our communities, it's good for our economy, and ultimately it's good for our country. When children grow up with opportunities, they become adults who contribute to society in meaningful ways, a society where potential is fulfilled, as a society that thrives. And I'm grateful that my country invested in me and my children so that we can now pay that back. But potential can only be realised when the roadblocks are removed. The barriers that poverty creates, be they financial, social or educational, are often dictated by the circumstances a child is born into. And it's our responsibility to remove those barriers and ensure that every child has the chance to succeed, no matter their background. What I've came to realise, though, both in my personal experience and in my work here in the Parliament, is how often we overlook welfare as an investment. Welfare is not a burden on society. It's a crucial investment in the health, happiness and productivity of our people. By ensuring that people have the support they need, we are laying the groundwork for a thriving economy and a stronger, more cohesive society. And it goes further than simply preventing immediate hardships. We're setting the stage for long-term success. Children who grow up with food security, stable housing and access to education are more likely to become healthy, productive adults who can contribute positively. The contrary causes pressure on public services and feeds the criminal justice system, for example. And as I thought about the Scottish Government's commitment to tackling child poverty, I pictured two possible futures for a child, one with support and one without. Take a child, for example, called Scott. Born into financial hardship, their future could follow two very different paths. In one scenario, Scott's parents receive a baby box filled with essentials for those early months, and they get the Scottish Child Payment. The small financial lifeline helps keep the heating on, puts healthy meals on the table, and maybe they even enjoy a family day out. Scott goes to nursery with free quality education, giving them the best start in life. The parents, relieved of childcare costs, can balance work and home life, slowly building a stable future. But in another scenario, there's no baby box, no child payment. The family struggles to afford the basics and the stress spills over into Scott's life with no free childcare. The parents face an impossible choice: stay at home to care for Scott or take on extra work, leaving Scott without that crucial early education. The family remains stuck in survival mode and Scott struggles to get ahead of their peers. Free school meals, affordable housing, these are more than just policies. They're the difference between children like Scott having the chance to thrive or being held back by the circumstances beyond their control. And it isn't just support, it's an investment in our children, our communities, our NHS and our country's future. And when we break down those barriers of poverty, every child can have a myriad of opportunities opened up to them. But as much as we want to strive to tackle child poverty here in Scotland, we're confined by devolution. And without the full powers of independence, we are reliant on the UK government, exercising those powers that we do not hold. Their policies do include the two-child limit on benefits and a cap on universal credit, a welfare system that fails to guarantee even the most basic of essentials. They could choose to remove these poverty-causing barriers and lift an additional 40,000 children out of poverty in Scotland. At a time when Tory and now Labour austerity continues to place pressure on public finances, we must all call on the UK Government to follow in the footsteps of the Scottish Government, prioritising the eradication of child poverty, and never forget that investing in our children's future is not a cost, it's a benefit. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Marie McNair. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking Karen Adam for what I think is a very affecting account of her own experience of the real benefits of the welfare state from some years ago. I think it's quite moving in times. And not often we hear that language about how enabling and empowering the benefits system, as it's described, can be. We often hear very negative language about people's experience of it. When we talk about the reality of that situation, I don't agree with her that we are confined by devolution in this Parliament. In fact, I think we're empowered by it. There are many things that have been described today by the front bench already, and I'm sure we'll hear more of them, that this Parliament and the government that serves it does so much more. That benefits from that additional funding of £2,417 per head, per pot in the population, and we can decide how we want to spend that extra money, and rightly so, on the child payment, which I think Mr. Paul Kane set out clearly our support for and the difference that it makes to families across Scotland. So I welcome the debate that we have here today as part of the programme for government, one of the key priorities that we are told by the First Minister. And in the programme yesterday from him, we heard certainly little new in ways, but significant reduction in means. And it has, as stated out by colleagues, now the third First Minister to make child poverty reduction their priority. And there has been little progress in doing so. In fact, 30,000 more children in poverty in Scotland than there was when this SNP government came to power. And obviously child poverty has grown since Labour left government in the UK as a direct result of the decisions made by Conservative governments. But both in terms of the choices that they made over funding and significant reductions in the welfare state and the benefits that were paid to people, but crucially in the kind of economy that that Conservative government thought that we should have, a low wage, low skill and low growth economy where inequality has grown both for communities and between communities. And we know that at the end of this Parliament that has just finished, we had, for the first time in history, families were poorer than at the outset of that Parliament. A clear indication in terms of the amount of the economic growth that has been lost and the benefit to people, and how that would actually make a difference in people's incomes and to into their bank balances. And I do believe that it has been a significant departure, but 8 weeks into this government. And we should, all governments should be judged in the long term in terms of what they managed to do and managed to achieve over the many years, for instance, that the SNP have an unprecedented term in government here in Scotland. And no government does get everything right. We know that. And this Labour government will not get everything right, of course, just as this SNP government certainly has not. But we should be judged in the long term. But the early signs are positive. The first action we took was to instruct the Low Pay Commission to establish a living wage. So many people in poverty are in work. And that scandal of low pay to be addressed through the New Deal for Working People and enhanced rights makes a significant difference to that. And those rights reflect one of the key problems, Presiding Officer, in terms of people accessing work, whether it be rights on day one, and we'll be removing the problems of zero-hour contracts and making sure we can deal with those. But we also need to address the economy as it is, rather than how we would rather have it be. So we know that whether we have 1140 hours of childcare commitment in Scotland, that we have to make sure that there's increased flexibility within it. And I know that some of what the Cabinet Secretary set out in her open remarks were around that area of flexibility and things that have been done in Dundee for a small cohort of people, and we would like to see what the evidence of that and what it can do and make that difference. I would commend her the work of Flexible Childcare Services Scotland, also operating in Dundee, who put in place that provision where people can actually, if they get offered an extra shift in their work, sometimes at absolutely no notice at all, they have the option to send their child into that care to make sure that they can realise that shift and put that extra money in their bank balance, which makes a massive difference. We also need to ensure that there is access to proper work. We had a visit from the Finance Committee to the University of Dundee just last week. I was happy to have the committee in my home city. And I asked the question of senior management, how could we ensure careers, opportunities, not just for new Dundonians as part of that very international community, but for people who have been in Dundee for many years, and we have a significant issue of people out of the labour market. And the senior management were clear that the funded pathway into employment in those kind of jobs has been narrowed and narrowed. The upskilling fund, graduate apprenticeships, all dropped in terms of the provisions made by the government. So those are the routes out of poverty for many people and in work poverty, Presiding Officer. So, and we should be clear that contrary to the statistical contortions, frankly, of the First Minister over the last 24 hours, the attainment gap is growing in Scotland. That's absolutely clear. And I don't think that's any doubt in terms of in Dundee. Again, I've used that example. The cuts to attainment funding that were made by the previous Cabinet Secretary for Education from the poorest communities, and that money was spread more widely across the country. But it did make a significant cut to the available money to the poorest communities in Scotland. And we see today the cuts to the free school meals promise. And that is, and let's not doubt, the result of the budget and the mishandling of the finances that this government has made. And we can look to the Institute for Fiscal Studies, the Fraser of Allendale Institute, Audit Scotland, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, that say that that choice is a result of their mistakes. That choice is a result of their mistakes. So this is the third First Minister to set the destination, but as in so many, many ways, across those many, many top priorities, this is a government that's lost its way.
Thank you, Mr. Barrett. And I call Marie McNair, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Oliver Mundell. Ms. McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate on the programme for government and the Scottish Government's commitment to eradicating child poverty. And it is essential that this is the single most important objective of the Scottish Government. The First Minister is right to say that the material wealth of a child's family should not hold them back in a modern and prosperous Scotland. So I welcome the intended approach set out with him yesterday and the Cabinet Secretary today. I also take this opportunity to put on record my thanks to all the volunteers, charities and advice agencies in my constituency who are on the front line. They are there and they're always there, providing support to so many in poverty. Despite the harsh Westminster welfare regime, the actions of the Scottish Government are making a difference in tackling child poverty. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, I regularly hear from the charities, academics and those with lived experience about the positive impact of the Scottish Child Payment. The Poverty Alliance has stated that the Scottish Child Payment is having a demonstrably positive impact on an individual household and the family level, with Social Security Scotland processes having made applying for the support both less stigmatising and rooted in human rights. And from the Poverty and Inequality Commission, the Scottish Child Payment is undoubtedly a game changer, and the importance in reducing child poverty of delivering the Scottish Child Payment and getting cash directly to families cannot be overstated. The Commission's view has consistently been that the Scottish Child Payment is the main contributor to progress in reducing child poverty at the national level. And evidence gathered from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation from their 4,000-person survey, they found that 2 in 3 people felt more financially secure once they received the Scottish Child Payment. This is a hugely significant policy and one that's doing a lot of heavy lifting. Importantly, what a lot of experts note is that despite the improvements from the Scottish Government in tackling child poverty, without significant action from the UK Government, we will continue to see children stuck in poverty. And this is made clear by the academic Juliet Stone, who states that the Scottish Child Payment is for many families simply acting to offset the consequences of UK-level policies that restricted income, most importantly, the two-child limit and the benefit cap. Fully addressing child poverty in Scotland therefore requires action at a UK level as well as a national level. And this really is the elephant in the room. So instead of a predictable heckling and jeering and relishing of a possible attack on the SNP if targets are not met, a reminder instead to all colleagues across the chamber, the targets on reducing child poverty are not the SNP's alone. They are targets set by our Parliament. They belong to us all. And the need is really to genuinely contribute to finding solutions, and they need both governments working together. It can be no joy for the Labour Party MSPs that Tory welfare policy is continuing, Labour's two-child policy and its abhorrent rape clause is denying children what they need to thrive, and they dutifully campaign for those who were when elected and followed the herd, so they should at least have the decency to tell children why they've been denied the basic levels of subsistence. How can they say they're serious about eradicating child poverty when they failed at the first hurdle? The Scottish Government will not shy away from admitting more can be done. However, without significant action from the UK Government to tackle poverty, our efforts will always be hindered. In ignoring the evidence that is readily available, Labour is failing at the first big test of government by ignoring the national scandal of child poverty. And that was clear when they suspended seven of their MPs who voted to scrap the two-child cap in July. Perhaps the only true socialist parliamentarians left in their party are now removed. According to Child Poverty Action Group, one in nine children are affected by the two-child limit, and that's more than 1.6 million children. And this policy is actively causing deprivation, and every year it pushes more children into poverty. Labour is making the political choice to keep children in poverty while lifting the cap on bankers' bonuses. And that's the harsh reality of this matter. Prioritising eradicating child policy, do the right thing and scrap the two-child policy and the benefit cap. We also need to see an essentials guarantee within universal credit. And the Trussell Trust point out that almost half of people claiming universal credit ran out of food in the last month and did not have enough money to buy more. And they're clear that universal credit is failing short and pushing people into food banks. So while the UK Labour Party continue to leave children in poverty and argue amongst themselves, the Scottish Government will get on with protecting children in poverty. We will continue to lead the way in tackling child poverty. As for us, this is not just a policy goal, it's a moral imperative and one that we will remain dedicated to achieving. So let's push forward on this and continue to prioritise eradicating child poverty. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call Oliver Mundell to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm perhaps less generous than some colleagues and less optimistic than Willie Rennie, because I find myself arriving here today, I'm really wondering what the point of this debate is. I don't think it's real, and I'm not sure what's depressed me most, the suggestion that we're confined by devolution, or to watch the glee and joy so many SNP MSPs have taken in pivoting their attacks and questions from the Conservatives onto the Labour Party. It seems that some of these things are actually more about politics than moral duty. And I think it's only this Scottish Government, led by this First Minister, that could have the brass neck to come here and try and hide behind the most disadvantaged in our society in order to try and detract from their disastrous tenure. The First Minister talked of the past 25 years, but I think he's looking back through rose-tinted spectacles, because the truth is the Scotland we see today does not live up to the early promise of this Parliament. And the blame lies squarely with the SNP, who have squandered the opportunity across the past 17 years to build a better Scotland. Because the truth is, Scotland is a grim place to grow up for many young people, and the ministers sitting on the SNP front benches, many of them have been there to oversee every minute of that for the last 17 years. So we all know today, much like the promise to close the poverty attainment gap or to make education their number one priority, this latest bold ambition will remain just that. And it's not worth the paper it's written on. There is little hope, only the same false promises and failed solutions from the same people who keep getting it so badly wrong. Yes, they have shifted the dial, but only in a negative direction. Our once proud education system is a shadow of its former self. Our NHS is crumbling and shrinking inwards towards urban centres. The promise of a good job and a fair crack at the whip is out of reach for many. But of course, it's always easier to blame someone else, or in the SNP's case, everyone else. But it does a disservice to this generation and to future generations. We hear that budgets are tight, but bad decisions have been made year after year after year. The wrong priorities pursued for the wrong reasons. No strategic oversight or vision. And we see that again now. How can you announce that you want to eradicate child poverty at the same time as rowing back on commitments to deliver free school meals? How can the First Minister stand up yesterday and again today at First Minister's questions and talk about having the right support available through pregnancy to birth, when in the Scotland he leads, Scotland in 2024, some health boards in our country
don't even offer in-person antenatal classes, and some of them don't even offer them online. We live in a country where our government can no longer get the basics right, where it's lost a grip on health boards and on many of the other quangos and organisations that it's responsible for. And that's before we even move on to consider whether the First Minister's own drive to address child poverty is really credible. This, lest we forget, is an experienced and skilled politician who served as both Scotland's Finance Secretary and Education Secretary, all the while brushing away serious challenges in the system and throwing around political insults and soundbites. And I know there's been a transformation and a whole new approach since getting the top job, but I, for one, don't believe it. The problem is, as well, many of the challenges that we have go beyond simply money, and they stretch over so many budget years, it makes it laughable to suggest that they couldn't have been, that changes couldn't have been made if the will had been there. And some of them don't, as I say, come down to money, but are questions of leadership. We have a litany of failed promises, from tackling the cost of the school day, we heard about that again at the start of today's debate, but very little has been done on it. Branded uniforms are still commonplace in most schools. There are lots of hidden costs in the school day, such as milk. There are no breakfast clubs in many parts of the country, no after-school provision in most parts of the country. Challenges for people accessing childcare. Yes, it's good we have 11, 40 hours, but if it's not there and it's not flexible enough to allow families to go to work, words in this chamber mean nothing. We've heard, as always, from government members about the good bits of policy, but they need to have the moral courage to admit that it's patchwork at best, and that many of the measures set out are sticking plasters that offer no bold or radical solutions. If this was just a one-off, maybe we could agree that it's down to budget pressures, but we all know that the lack of vision goes far beyond that. And most families in Scotland know that when things are tight, you focus on what really matters. Even as this SNP government announces for I don't know how many time a laser-like focus on eradicating child poverty, its decisions show its focus remains all over the place. In short, Presiding Officer, this year's programme for government amounts to nothing more than a mirage of activity in what has been a 17-year-long desert of SNP neglect. It's just a shame that the people of Scotland will have to wait another 20 months before they get the chance to call time on this waste of time approach. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mundell. And I now call Colette Stevenson. Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Eradicating child poverty is the single greatest priority for the SNP Scottish Government. No one's opportunities should be dictated by the circumstances they are born into. And supporting every child in Scotland is the greatest investment we can make in our future. Of course, poverty is a multifaceted issue which requires a range of interventions, and I'll try to touch on some key matters this afternoon. Social security is one of those areas and a key part of the Scottish Government's work to tackle child poverty was the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment. Charities called this a game-changing policy and many academics have spoken of its significance. Professor Danny Dorlan, for example, has talked about the impact of the payment on changing the inequality level in Scotland. He also suggested that the Scottish Child Payment has perhaps caused the largest fall in child poverty anywhere in Europe since the fall of the Berlin Wall. Professor Ruth Patrick told the Social Justice and Social Security Committee that the payment is a really well-targeted policy which corrects the UK government's divorcing of the relationship between needs and entitlement. The Scottish Child Payment is worth £26.70 per eligible child per week and puts money into the pockets of hard-pressed parents. The latest data shows that more than 4,400 children in East Kilbride receive the Scottish Child Payment, so low-income families in East Kilbride are benefiting directly from over £500,000 every month from the payment. Of course, policies like the Scottish Child Payment don't exist in a vacuum. Right now, the SNP government is mitigating the worst of policies introduced by the Tories, like the bedroom tax and benefit cap. This mitigation of Westminster welfare policies has cost the SNP government around £1.2 billion since 2010. I hope the Labour government in Westminster will take time to reflect on their plans, because by keeping Tory fiscal rules, Labour will be forcing more austerity on the people of Scotland. So in the face of Labour cuts at Westminster, Scotland's government must work harder and smarter to deliver for Scotland using the limited resources available. The programme for government sets out some of the ways that we can do this, particularly in terms of child poverty. And as the First Minister outlined, eradicating child poverty and boosting economic growth go hand in hand. It is estimated that child poverty costs the Scottish economy over £3 billion in 2023 as a result of lower productivity and the investment required to mitigate poverty's harmful effects. The First Minister's vision to grow Scotland's economy and create jobs will, in turn, support investment in Scotland's vital public services and ambitious anti-poverty measures. And this ties in with the Social Justice and Social Security Committee's work on parental employment. Another important area is housing. We know there are challenges there, particularly with house building in the current economic climate. And of course, Westminster's £1.3 billion cut to Scotland's capital budget. However, the SNP in government is continuing to deliver more affordable housing per person than in England and Wales. We've already delivered over 130,000 affordable homes. And as the programme for government outlined, another £600 million will be invested this year to continue that work. Sorry, I'm just going to move on. Thank you. With this investment in affordable housing, the SNP government is keeping rents lower and benefiting around 140,000 children in poverty each year. Members on the benches opposite might not want to hear this, but Chris Burke told the Social Justice and Social Security Committee about research the Joseph Rowntree Foundation did, which found that the Scottish Government's investment in social housing has made a significant difference in keeping poverty levels lower than elsewhere in the UK. Presiding Officer, the SNP Government is delivering for the people of Scotland. We've built a new social security system with dignity, fairness and respect at its heart. We've rolled out 7 benefits unique to Scotland, including the game-changing Scottish Child Payment. We've increased early learning and childcare to 1140 hours per year, and we've delivered free bus travel for everyone under 22. Taken together, the SNP government's policies are estimated to be keeping 100,000 children out of poverty this year. And we're doing that with the limited powers of devolution. The new UK Labour government must take inspiration from what the SNP has achieved. They should introduce an equivalent of the Scottish Child Payment in the rest of the UK. And they must also get rid of Tory welfare reforms, such as the two-child cap and the bedroom tax. And that would let Scottish Government invest more in its anti-poverty measures. And if they don't, more and more people will see that the only way to actually get change for Scotland is to become an independent country.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. We will now move to closing speeches. I'm disappointed to note that 2 members who participated in the debate are not here. That is disrespectful to every other member who participated in the debate, and it's disrespectful to the chair. Perhaps those comments could be passed on by their colleagues. I call on Maggie Chapman to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This afternoon we have heard, and in the many briefings circulated for this debate, had shared with us so many examples of the Christie Commission's findings of the generational effects of social and economic inequalities and of the imperative, more urgent than ever, to prioritise prevention. The prevention of poverty and thereby the prevention of pain, ill health, physical and psychological scars and so much more must motivate each and every one of us. We've heard, too, how the sticking plasters, like food banks, are buckling under burgeoning demand. Poverty is a political choice, and yes, we are all responsible for the choices we make. Willie Rennie will, I am sure, embrace as his own all the decisions made when his party was instigating and perpetuating austerity as part of the UK government for those fateful 5 years. There are consequences to the decisions we take as politicians. And I am proud, for example, that it was the Scottish Greens' influence 2.5 years ago that saw the mitigation of the UK government's benefit cap written into the Tackling Child Poverty Action Plan. Was it enough? No, clearly not, not nearly enough. But that is why we need to heed the calls for action on the fundamentals of poverty prevention. CPAG's briefing for today clearly identifies the areas that must be our focus. Social security, employment and childcare, cost of the school day, tax and housing. Alongside the urgently needed increase to the Scottish Child Payment, we must plug the gaps in Scotland's social security system. And we must remember that the right to decent living standards is not restricted according to nationality or immigration status. Close the Gap reinforces CPAG's call for employment support, especially for parents experiencing intersectional barriers to well-paid, secure, flexible work and childcare that is free, accessible and flexible. And several people have talked about that this afternoon. I, like others have done so, celebrate that we have the social security system that we do in Scotland. Social security is not a burden. It is not something that we should be ashamed of. It is a mark of a decent, compassionate, and humane society that values collective care and responsibility for each other, not the individualised alienation that has been the consequence of too many years of Tory rule in Westminster. We've heard much in this chamber today already about the need for sufficient support for the costs of the school day, particularly school meals. Universalism matters. It destigmatises, it equalises, and it endows recipients with equal respect and worth. And there is undoubtedly more we can do to reduce the cost of the school day. Uniforms, trips and activities, and digital devices, which are no luxury, but an essential tool for learning today. Others, including Colette Stevenson and Miles Briggs, have spoken about the importance of decent, secure homes for all children. We do need to see action on the affordable housing supply programme. As shelter and crisis have shown us, ending child poverty is impossible without ending the housing emergency, with almost 10,000 children in temporary accommodation, up 138% since 2014, and another 45 children becoming homeless every day. I urge colleagues on the Labour benches to press their Prime Minister to end the two-child limit. Not wait for a wholesale review of benefits. We know it's wrong now. It needs to go now. We are living through a transition, whether we want to or not. The climate and nature emergencies can't step aside and wait while a couple of governments argue over who is most to blame. The question is whether that transition will be one of justice or one of oppression. Cutting budgets for walking, wheeling and cycling, bringing back peak rail fares, none of this grows a world in which today's children can breathe and thrive, in which today's parents can model the behaviour that we all will depend on. So yes, our decisions do matter. I'd much rather see money currently going to subsidise private companies or investment in unproven, unreliable or very expensive technologies that won't actually help us address any of the emergencies we face, going to vital services that our children and their families need. So I urge the government to think again about the short-sighted cuts, about the losses to the budget for children's rights, protection and justice, about its shamefully diluted position on free school meals. I ask the government to imagine the position of carers especially single parents who are kept in poverty solely by the randomness of childcare provision. And I implore the government to think again about dropping its commitments to a human rights bill and a ban on conversion practices, commitments it once made to the most marginalised, the most excluded, in the most silenced of our neighbours. The human rights legislation in particular could be an important tool to tackle child poverty. It could provide the framework for focusing public expenditure and improving our public services, helping us deliver our minimum core obligations. Indeed, we cannot achieve the laudable mission to eradicate child poverty without meeting our minimum core obligations. So in closing, Presiding Officer, there are stark choices to be made by a government facing tough financial decisions. It is up to us to ensure that the consequences, the burdens of those decisions, of those financial choices we make, do not fall upon the shoulders of Scotland's most marginalised people, on the shoulders of our children. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Pam Duncan-Glancy, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to close this debate on one of the most important issues facing Scotland today. Growing up in poverty impacts life chances, sees pupils denied their potential and life goals, and it stifles opportunity. As many members, including Miles Briggs, Karen Adams, the Cabinet Secretary, Maggie Chapman and others have spoken of today. But the truth is, in Scotland, after years of SNP and Tory waste and mismanagement on finances, inequality and poverty have soared. There are 40,000 more children in poverty today than there were in Scotland a decade ago. Both governments had let Scotland's young people down. I suspect that's why the SNP are lining up today with the Tories to attack Labour and our plans to deliver stronger workers' rights and wages, because they can't stand on their own record. Unlike the Tories and the SNP, though, I will in 2 seconds, the last Labour government's record is different. In government, we lifted 1 million children out of poverty. It is theirs that is the failure Marie McNair and others sets out. Ours is a record I'm proud of, and I'll take the intervention from Bob Dorris.
Bob Dorris.
Confused by Ms Glancy's logic, could Ms Glancy explain why child poverty levels in Wales are far higher under Labour than it is in Scotland under the SNP?
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I'd suggest gently to the member that he might want to look at his own government's record on child poverty before he starts pointing fingers at others. The eradication of child poverty must be a national mission for the Scottish Government, as colleagues including Paul O'Kane, Willie Rennie, Annie Wells have agreed. And it is for the new UK Labour Government. And the members on the government benches here say that it is their priority. In fact, as my colleague Michael Mara pointed out, 3 First Ministers have said it's their priority, but their actions don't back up their words. John Swinney, Hamza Youssef and Nicola Sturgeon have all broken their promises to the young people of Scotland. They slashed the affordable housing budget, as my colleague Miles Briggs highlighted. They froze the Scottish Welfare Fund, abandoned parental employability schemes, cut teacher numbers in MCR pathways, cut the employability budget by £21 million and parental employability funds by £20 million. And yesterday, they abandoned their pledge on free school meals and revised down their ambitions to close the attainment gap. It could not be clearer, Presiding Officer. This government has no plan, no strategy, and now it seems no ambition on child poverty. Because, Presiding Officer, broken promises and no ambition will not be forgotten by Scotland's young people. And it's not just the stuff their government have failed to do that's the issue. It's the constant dogged-headed in the sand approach that they're right and what they're doing. It was their own Commission on Poverty that said the next progress report cannot just point to actions already taken nor propose more scale to small-scale tests of change. The Scottish Government needs to restore faith and renew optimism. So the Government can list policies that they think contribute to reducing poverty all they want, and the Finance Secretary can pretend on the radio that more of the same will work. But organisations can see through it, and 260,000 children in Scotland can tell them the reality. The Poverty Commission, whilst recognising the impact that we do too of the Scottish Child Payment, also said, and SNP MSPs might want to listen to this, that progress in other areas is too slow or not evident at all. Presiding Officer, all of this can change. As many of us know, poverty is not inevitable. Change is possible. In just 8 weeks, the new UK Labour administration has already acted. We will tackle child poverty at its roots with a new deal for working people to deliver a real living wage, whilst reviewing universal credit so that it makes work pay and tackles poverty. We'll deliver a genuine pay rise for more than 200,000 of the lowest paid Scots. We'll tackle the cost of living crisis by establishing GB Energy, a publicly owned energy company that will drive down energy bills. We'll deliver affordable public transport and housing support.
Ms Duncan Glancy. Thank you very much. I'm very keen that I can hear you, and I'm aware of conversations happening across the chamber. So if we could just focus on Ms Duncan Glancy's words. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We'll deliver a genuine pay rise for more than 200,000 of the lowest paid Scots, tackle the cost of living by establishing GB Energy, a publicly owned energy company that will help drive down energy bills, deliver affordable public transport and housing support, end problem debt and provide help and support for families and households across Scotland. That is the difference a progressive government can make, and that's what we'll strive every day to deliver. To do the work this SNP government are failing to do. We will spread opportunity for all. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Ros McCall. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to close the debate today on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I welcome the contributions across the floor. There is absolute cross-party support for the objectives we're discussing today, and that members on these benches fully agree that there should be a full and fervent focus on eradicating child poverty. I note the government's motion, but I'll be speaking to the Scottish Conservative amendment, as I think the various statistics in there paint a very concerning picture over the lack of tangible movement rather than funding allocations. We cannot fully accept that the Scottish child payment is the panacea when 26% of children live in poverty, a number that's barely changed in 17 years, and that 10,000 children live in temporary accommodation, an astounding 138% increase in a decade, and that the health of children are adversely affected by poverty, with a number of pediatric waits increasing by a staggering 114.6%. And all of this falls under the SNP government and its mismanagement. But before I get into my particular comments, I will. Thank you very much.
Gordon MacDonald.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying about the Scottish Government should take responsibility for the 24% of children who are in poverty. Could you tell me who should take responsibility for the 30% of children in England who are in poverty, or the 29% of children who are in poverty in Wales?
Always through the chair, please. Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm going to stick to my lines because we are in Scotland and it is in Scotland that we will look. But I will go on to my comments, but before I do, I'm actually going to take a couple of the contributions that are here. The Cabinet Secretary for Education, in her opening remarks, talked about the 1140 hours, and we all welcomed the 1140 hours. And I was a councillor in Perth and Kinross when we were putting the processes through. And everything that we talked about as every single stage was it needed to be totally funded and it needed to have a complete blended offer with the private sector, with the PVI sector and with childminders. And unfortunately, as much as the provision has come in, it isn't meeting that. So I accept the words from the Cabinet Secretary, but it's not working for everybody. Miles Briggs talks about a holistic approach on health and housing. I think that's very important. I support the request he made for a bespoke child health welfare strategy. I also noticed comments on the worrying position of diminishing housing completions at a record low and the reduced pipeline of new social homes, which is very concerning, when I don't think that's got anything to do with the capital budget reductions. And I welcome the intervention from the Cabinet Secretary of Social Justice highlighting plans with COSLA on his point to look at bringing council properties back into use, and I actually look forward to hearing more on the detail on that work when it comes through. Willie Rennie, as usual, made an excellent contribution, and I also regret that we happen to be in the position of needing a child payment, and I agree that we need to find ways of looking to help people help themselves. And I also note his comments on the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, and again, the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice did respond to that, and I appreciate it because a Freedom of Information request says that initial payments, a lot of it, have gone on council funding for staff, and I really hope to see that we now make a move moving forward that actually does what it's meant to do. And my last point, as many people have mentioned, is the Scottish payment, the child payment. 100,000 children kept out of poverty. That was Bob Dornan, Marie McNair, both the Cabinet Secretaries and Colette Stevens have mentioned that. But again, I just want to highlight that Professor Danny Dorning, who again was mentioned by Ms. Colette Stevenson, he also mentioned that we have to be careful that we're not just looking at the statistics of this, of moving from one side of an arbitrary line to another. There needs to be more work to make sure that any analysis actually takes into consideration the changes that we have, and we can't just focus on an arbitrary line. Yes, I will do. Thank you.
Bob Doris.
Just very briefly, and it's not a partisan point, would you agree with me, would the member agree with me that we heard in committee there needs to be a comparative study in England and Scotland and Wales about efforts to tackle child poverty to work out an evidence base of what's working and adopt it on a pan-UK basis?
Ross McCall.
Yes, I do accept that that came forward in committee, and I want to just again raise the point that we have to be careful that this is not just looking at how we move across an arbitrary line, which was my point, but I do accept the fact that there needs to be more work in analysis moving forward. As with all things, and especially within government, it's the choices we make and the way we go about it that only focuses the mind that means we either meet our objectives or not. Governments will always have some form of financial pressure that will inhibit the way we take government strategy forward into operational processes. And no matter what political spin we apply on this chamber or what circumstances we're subjected to, whether they're global or national or local, that affect the status quo, we are charged to do right by the people of Scotland. So given that we're here to discuss the laudable goal of eradicating child poverty, we need to look at all the avenues we can do to make that happen. And a greater holistic approach has to be adopted. And once again, I find myself turning to my usual parental employment as an example. We know that there is a tried and tested way out of poverty, not an indirect government wealth redistribution process, but a direct way to help people to help themselves. We also know there are three main factors holding people back from achieving this, and that's childcare, transport, and retraining. Childcare. The government has again highlighted 1140 hours, and I accept that. But this is a system that is under a lot of pressure, and we have restrictions to government offer being applied in councils right across the country. We have workers not being able to access a council nursery near their place of employment. We have some council areas postponing start dates in comparison to others. And wraparound care, including childminders in the PVI sector, is stretched almost to breaking point. Transport. We have bus services being cut right across rural areas. Timings of bus travel are not meeting the needs of people, and as more and more flexible working becomes the norm. And we have peak fares returning for rail travellers because at the reduced rate, people were let down by the Scottish Government's own ScotRail service so much that they couldn't be enticed by half price. And cuts to college sector mean that any chances of retraining for many are simply beyond possible. And it's a triple whammy, presiding officer, and it's halting any progression into work. And the members on these benches know that more people working not only affects the goals of reducing child poverty, but in these times of, how did the motion put it, a time when public finances are under acute pressure, it grows the economy, increases the tax intake and revenue, broadens tax base and makes it more secure, gives governments more additional spending for essential services in our community. So it's a win-win. In conclusion, the Scottish Government must take responsibility for the financial predicament it finds itself in, accept the harsh reality backed up by independent financial experts that is down to this government's choices, shift focus to a holistic approach including parental employment and returning empty buildings to housing stock, and actively make a difference for the children of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Shirley-Ann Somerville to wind up the debate, and if you could take us to 5 p.m, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to begin by thanking all the members across the Chamber for their contributions. Presiding Officer, this programme for government shows our commitment to supporting families in Scotland, and it sets out the next steps that we will take in our national mission to lift children out of poverty. As the Cabinet Secretary for Finance set out earlier this week, we do so in the context of the most severe financial challenges facing the Parliament in its history. Challenges that are the results of failures of the previous UK government, as the Chancellor has recently stated. But now we are told by the new Prime Minister that things will only get worse. Despite this, the Scottish Government is building on a firm foundation with investment of around £3 billion a year to tackle poverty, mitigate the cost of living crisis as far as we can, and invest in the prevention to break the cycle of poverty. Now, that does include the unparalleled support provided by the Scottish Child Payment and our five family payments. More than 325,000 children and young people were benefiting from the Scottish Child Payment as of the end of June. And overall, the Child Poverty Action Group estimates that low-income families in Scotland will be around £28,000 better off by the time their child turns 18, compared to families across the UK, as a result of the decisions taken by this government. That is delivery, and that is impact. Now, the actions set out in the programme for government build upon this foundation, and they seek to drive progress together with partners. And we know that families will only be able to thrive if they have access to the right support at the right time. And I saw that change that support can make when I recently visited Allo Academy with the First Minister to meet young people and their families and hear more about the Clackmannanshire Family Wellbeing Partnership. Now, we want to work with partners, not just in Clackmannanshire, but in other local authorities to remove the barriers to progress and support the change needed to provide that holistic support. And that's why the programme for government sets out how we'll do this through our ongoing work with partners and by expanding our place-based partnerships to five more areas in North Ayrshire, East Ayrshire, Perth and Kinross, Inverclyde and Aberdeen. Through these partnerships, more families will receive the support that they need when they need it. But we know, important though that policy is, there is no silver bullet to ending child poverty in Scotland. We'll only be able to do so with relentless focus, both nationally and locally, and indeed in partnerships with organisations the length and breadth of the country. The First Minister has made clear that lifting children out of poverty is a top priority for this government, and I'm pleased to say that to drive this progress, he has decided to form a new Cabinet subcommittee on child poverty. This will ensure the full weight and the full authority of Cabinet is focused on this mission in his tenure. Now, by working together with the full effort of national and local government, the third sector and business, can we come together, we'll deliver joined-up, whole-system approaches to making this change possible. Together, we can turn the tide.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for giving me. I'm a bit confused by the Cabinet subcommittee. If this is the government's overarching priority, should it not be a policy priority that runs through every single portfolio? And, for example, is hiking rail fares for hard-pressed families not completely contrary to the things that she'll be setting out herself?
Cabinet Secretary.
With respect to Oliver Mundell, I think there's a misunderstanding about how the Cabinet and subcommittees work to ensure that that extra focus is given above and beyond what actually already happens in Cabinet. And the Cabinet Secretary for Transport has already laid out some of the reasons behind the decisions that she's taken on the peak rail fares. Now, can I turn, Presiding Officer, to the UK Government? Because while we are determined to do as much as we can, as we always have, to tackle child poverty, we do need to ensure that both governments that are here to serve Scotland do that. Now, to that end, I do welcome, as Paul O'Kane has suggested, I welcome the announcement from the new UK Government of that ministerial task force on child poverty. Their stated intention is, of course, to work closely with the devolved government to meet shared ambitions, and I stand ready to work with the UK government on that, and I have made that approach directly to the relevant secretaries of state in my meetings. But I say again, and it has been mentioned in this debate, along with that strategy, the UK government does need to take action now. To quote, no child poverty strategy will be credible unless the two-child limit is scrapped at the autumn budget. Not my words, Presiding Officer, but the words of Dan Paskins, Executive Director of Save the Children UK. The new UK Poverty Task Force has stressed it will listen to experts. Well, I certainly hope that they do, but I hope that they actually listen to experts long before and take that action within the budget. They have the ability to do so. Now, there are a number of areas where members have mentioned specifics in the debate, and I don't have time to go through them all, but I will endeavour to approach some. Paul O'Kane mentioned the modelling aspect. The Scottish Government has published the full and detailed methodology on the child poverty modelling. I would invite members to review that entire document. And the chair of the UK Stats Authority has described this kind of analysis as a reasonable way to estimate the impact of Scottish Government policies. I hope that gives the member reassurance, and I hope that gives them some interesting bedtime or weekend reading if he wants to take that up further. Many members mentioned mitigation that the Scottish Government takes up, and they are right to do so. We've spent £1.2 billion mitigating the impacts of UK Government policies, Tory and Labour. Whether it's the bedroom tax, where we mitigate to assist 92,000 households this year, whether it's the benefit cap, the shortfalls in local housing allowance. It's £134 million this year. That money could pay for 2,000 extra teachers. It could pay for 2,000 Band 5 nurses. But we are mitigating against UK austerity, both Tory and Labour. That also doesn't include the near £500 million we spend on the Scottish child payment, mitigating against the inadequacy of universal credit. That is a fantastic investment that we are making to protect people, but it shouldn't be required, and it is something that does need to be picked up by the UK Government at source. Because Willy Rennie, in a very thoughtful contribution on many aspects, he's quite right. We shouldn't celebrate the Scottish child payment. He is absolutely right that it is a tragedy that people need it in this society. But I am proud that we've stepped up to support these people, and I think that is the area where we can be proud of as a government. But he's right to make that point. He also talked about removing barriers over a number of issues, which I don't have time to get into today, but if Mr Rennie would care to have that further discussion at another time, I would be happy to go through some of the other points that he raised. When Pam Duncan-Glancy was closing presiding officer, she talked about what the last Labour government had done to lift people out of poverty. And she's right, there were many successes in that. You know the downside, though? It was followed by a Tory government for years. The bedroom tax was introduced, the rape clause was introduced, the working tax credits that they are so proud of are being scrapped. That is the union dividend, because when Labour can make some progress, no matter how much it is, quickly as night follows day, a Tory government will come along and blow that out of the water. And then you know what? Even when another Labour government does come along, they won't even have the bravery to take the early decisions on the bedroom tax, on the rape clause, to get us even back to where we were before. That is the difficulty of pretending that a new Labour government at a UK level will make the difference, because the Tories will unpick their work if any work is in progress is made at all. And the context that we are in is very important, whether it's austerity, whether it's the impact of Brexit, whether it's the cost of living crisis, whether it's the impact of inflation on the Scottish Government budget, that cumulative inflation of 18.9% over 3 years has made this difficult for the Government, but we are continued to do everything that we can. But it would be easier, presiding officer, if two governments could work together, and I hope that we do. But as Jenny Gilruth pointed out in her opening remarks, Conservative austerity is becoming Labour austerity. That now infamous line from Anas Sarwar, "Read my lips, no austerity under Labour," will continue to haunt him. It might have sounded good, presiding officer. It might have sounded good, presiding officer, while he was practising it before that debate, but I can assure him and others on the Labour benches, we will continue to remind them of that. And in the 8 weeks that we've had, let's look at where we've got so far. The Labour government have scrapped the universal winter fuel payment. The Labour Party during the election promised that they would reduce fuel bills by £300. And instead, Ofgem have confirmed they're going to go up by 10% this winter.
That, I don't think, presiding officer, was the change that people had in mind when they voted Labour, but that is the change that they've got. And you know what worries me even more, presiding officer, is what next? We've got Des McNulty, who used to sit in this parliament questioning the Scottish Child Payment. We've had Michael Mara in the past questioning free tuition fees. You do have to wonder if that's the change Anas Sarwar was talking about yesterday as well, presiding officer. So while this programme for government, with this government, has our next steps to provide the progress and delivery that we will have in our national mission of ending child poverty, we need that to be a collective one. I hope that right across the chamber,
Cabinet Secretary, I know that you're concluding and I am loath to interrupt, but I would ask members to treat one another with courtesy and respect and to avoid intervening from a sedentary position. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I completely appreciate that some of these closing remarks are uncomfortable for the Labour Party, and they should be, Presiding Officer. But this national mission that this government has is something which I do believe we can work across the chamber with, across every sector and indeed across Scotland. That is what this government is continued to do, and I hope that members across the chamber and indeed others will join us in that mission. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Programme for Government, Eradicating Child Poverty, and it's time to move on to the next item of business. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Miles Briggs is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Maggie Chapman will fall. The first question is that amendment 14322.2 in the name of Miles Briggs, which seeks to amend motion 14322 in the name of Jenny Gilruth on Programme for Government, Eradicating Child Poverty, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.